So week one of the 2017 NFL season has come and gone. It's great and exciting that football is back, but unfortunately that means we end up watching a lot of these games, and most of the games this week were doo-doo brutal bad. Let's hope the quality of play improves as the season goes along and isn't a reflection of the poor play we largely got last year. But let's talk about ultimately the week that was. I'm going to start off first with the biggest winners. You got to look to the Jacksonville Jaguars. This is a team with all of these questions about Blake Bortles as their starting quarterback. You go on the road to face J.J. Watt and the Houston Texans. All the emotion of that city, that community from Hurricane Harvey and its effects and the aftermath. People coming here for a distraction, trying to get away from the game. And ultimately, we should have called this game hashtag Hurricane Jaguars. They flooded the Texans early. They flooded them often. It was relentless. This was such a bad, brutal beatdown in week one on the road in Houston that the Jaguars' official Twitter feed changed their handle to Saxonville. It was so bad, Savage lasted a half as the starting quarterback. This was brutal. You have J.J. Watt and all the great things he did, all the money that he raised. He comes out and he gets this rousing ovation. And then for the Houston Texans, the two-time defending AFC South champions at home with the community looking to them to do something positive, to come out and lay that type of egg was horrendous. But for the Jacksonville Jaguars to come out, especially defensively, and just clown these guys and embarrass these guys and completely and totally poon and own these guys, that was something to see. It's supposed to be the Texans that have the best defense in this division, and by a bit. That might not be the case anymore. Hats off to the Jags, man. You earned it. Fournette with 100 yards rushing. Even with the bad news of Allen Robinson going down with an ACL injury and being lost for the year. You look at week one as week one. It was a really, really great way to kick off the season. You got to go to the Chiefs too. Thursday night, going on the road into Foxborough to face the defending Super Bowl champions, facing Tom Brady, Bill Belichick. And that shit didn't matter. Alex Smith was outstanding. Kareem Hunt was a stud, like a lot of us thought he could be, given the opportunity. Tyreek Hill was an explosive playmaker. The Chiefs made enough big plays happen when they needed to, and they put it on the New England Patriots and won going away. It was perhaps the single most impressive performance of week number one against that level of opponent on the road with that major spotlight to go out there and say, hey, we might be ready. It was a big night for the Kansas City Chiefs on Thursday. In terms of worst losses, Indianapolis Colts, what more do you need to say? But I'll look at the Cincinnati Bengals. You're hosting a divisional opponent in the Ravens at home, and you get shut out 20-0. Dalton was terrible. This team couldn't get anything going offensively, defensively. They were mediocre at best. And for a season that is Marvin Lewis put up or shut up time to the nth degree, to come out and lay the type of egg that the Cincinnati Bengals did in week one is an indication to me that there is trouble brewing throughout the course of this 2017 season. In terms of studs of the week, I look offensively, Alex Smith. For 1 week, I got to give the dude credit. He went 28 of 35, 368 yards, 4 touchdowns passing. I mean, they made that Patriots secondary look terrible. They made him look like the New Orleans Saints secondary. It was that brutal. And whether it be, you know, just a matter of Alex Smith took some chances that he normally wouldn't take, it's the pressure of feeling Patrick Mahomes breathing down his neck, whatever the case it was, for 1 week, it most certainly worked out because he went out there and outplayed Tom Brady. And if somebody had never watched football and you said, watch this game, one of these two guys is average to above average, and the other guy is a first ballot Hall of Famer, you would have come away from this one game, if you had never watched football before, thinking Alex Smith was that Hall of Famer. And then defensively, going back to the Jaguars, Calais Campbell, 4 sacks in his Jaguars debut. 4 sacks. he was a difference maker for a guy that I wasn't sure why this team brought him in, because I didn't think he was a great system fit. To come out and get four sacks like that and just completely and totally impose his will and make the Texans cry for mercy and wish Harvey was coming through the damn stadium, that's saying something. The ultimate dud of the week, the Indianapolis Colts. It's one thing to not have Andrew Luck, which they're not going to have him for several weeks to start off the season. It's another thing to go on the road to LA and lose to maybe a mediocre Rams team that doesn't have their best player in Aaron Donald. It's another thing to lose by a little bit. It's another thing to lose by a lot. It's another thing to lose in the fashion that you did with Scott Tolzien throwing multiple pick sixes and ultimately getting beat 46-9. You made Jared Goff look like Andrew Luck is supposed to look if he ever got on the damn field again. The ass-whooping factor was so great for the Indianapolis Colts that good old Chuck Strong himself, Chuck Pagano, didn't know what the hell hit him after the game when he sat there and said that the 49ers kicked their asses. And I'm paraphrasing, but notice the key phrase there, the key word there. Not the Rams stuck it to him. Not the Rams kicked their ass. The 49ers kicked their ass. This ass whooping was so severe and significant that Chuck Pagano got a concussion on the sideline and didn't know who the hell just administered that ass whooping. And Chuck, I know it's not going to matter because you're not going to have the job much longer, but it was the Los Angeles Rams. They were the truck that ran your ass over on Sunday. Now, each week here as part of the NFL recap video, I'm going to do what's called 4th and 10, which basically is just me giving 10 quick hot takes about some of the biggest, most newsworthy, notable items from the week that was in the National Football League. They're going to be quick, they're going to be fast, they're going to be hard, which is just how your mom likes it. Let's go, bitches! 4th and 10 starts now! Of course, after his massive performance on Thursday night, you could see all the Alex Smith defenders and fanboys come out of the woodworks from the NFL media via social media. Look at Alex Smith and all the explosive plays this offense has. He's playing better than Tom Brady. See, I told you he could throw the deep ball when he wants to. All I'm going to say is this. Is even the blind squirrel finds a nut every once in a while. And once a year, usually in week one, Alex Smith puts up big numbers and then reality sets in. If this is the hill that you choose to die on, then die away. And I will defer to the Chiefs organization on this matter. If Alex Smith was truly that guy, if Alex Smith actually could consistently stretch teams vertically, then why the hell did they trade up to get Patrick Mahomes? John Fox. NFL stands for National Football League. But if you continue to coach in a manner like you did in the first three quarters Sunday against the Atlanta Falcons, NFL, to borrow from Jerry Glanville, is going to stand for not for long with that chicken shit play calling. If you are to a point where you are that terrified of your starting quarterback and his inabilities, then why in the hell aren't you starting Mitchell Trubisky? Because I assure you, he could probably just as competently peak his handoff game on first, second, and third freaking down. And you're sending a negative message to your team by playing in such a close-to-the-fest conservative manner where you're playing not to lose instead of win, where you're ultimately telling your team that you don't think they're good enough to win. And if you continue to coach like this, I hope it's not for long for you with the Chicago Bears. To David Johnson's fantasy owners and season-long formats, I'm so sorry. Your number one pick is out for 2 to 3 months with a broken wrist. This is exactly why I play daily fantasy football. Because of BS like this. You take a David Johnson number one, and then he's out for 3 quarters of the season. I feel for you guys because I've been there before. It absolutely sucks. The Houston Texans traded up from 27 to 12 in the 2017 draft to get Deshaun Watson because they knew Tom Savage wasn't the answer. So if you knew Tom Savage wasn't the answer, why in the hell would you go into this season thinking it is a good idea to start said Tom Savage? You can talk about this as hindsight and revisionist history and all this other crap, but ultimately you made that big move up to go get Deshaun Watson because you knew Savage wasn't the guy. So you went out there week one in front of a city that badly needed something to latch onto and trotted out Tom Savage as your starting quarterback, which of course went exactly how you think it would go and a complete, total, unmitigated disaster. If this Houston Texans team doesn't make the playoffs this year, I wouldn't be surprised if Bill O'Brien is ultimately shown the door. Why? Because of bullshit like this. You traded up for Deshaun Watson. You drafted Deshaun Watson. Start Deshaun Watson! The Colts are at a point now where everybody knows the truth, and they probably already did. This team is terrible. Even if they had luck, they're not a playoff team. But without luck, it feels like if you replace the name Scott Tolzien or throw in Jacoby Brissett because it doesn't matter, and you called him Curtis Painter, you're looking at the 2011 Indianapolis Colts. And the point I'm getting at is let history repeat itself again if you're the Colts organization. Feel no pressure to bring back Andrew Luck. Do not play Andrew Luck one down in 2017. Intentionally tank. That way, Chris Ballard, you have the excuse to send Chuck Pagano finally out the freaking door. Get that marquee high top draft pick. Pray to God that a couple of these college quarterbacks are able to do big things to where other teams get giggly tits and they feel like they have to trade up into your spot in the 2018 draft. And that way, now you bring in a fresh and completely rested Andrew Luck into 2018 with years of potential draft pick bounty that you can finally build a championship contending team around your franchise guy. Many of us knew that this rookie class of running backs was going to be outstanding. We all sense it and we could feel it. And we were validated in week one. Kareem Hunt Thursday night, stud. Leonard Fournette against a tough Texans defense on Sunday, 100 yards rushing. Christian McCaffrey was one of the lesser performers, and he still had an okay game. Dalvin Cook Monday night broke Adrian Peterson's rookie opening game rushing record. Tariq Cohen for the Chicago Bears probably has some people in Chicago, I can only imagine, fantasizing about him taking over the starting job from Jordan Howard. It's cool to see when you know a class is really, really good and they come out from Jump Street and they make an impact, and it warms the cockles of my heart to see running backs can still be stars in the league, and I look forward to seeing what this rookie class of running backs is going to do all year long. Jeremy Lane got ejected for throwing a punch but didn't throw a punch. It's one thing to talk about the pussification of the National Football League, but making phantom calls and having that lead to a starter getting ejected is completely and totally ridiculous. And if one of the officials from that Green Bay-Seattle game on Sunday isn't suspended for week number two, there should be a criminal investigation because the Seahawks got hosed on that one. See a team like the Dallas Cowboys heavily invest in their offensive line, and it pays off bigly, to borrow a word from somebody. They're a Super Bowl contender, in large part because of said offensive line. And then you see teams like the Seattle Seahawks and the New York Giants criminally underinvest in their offensive line, and it's head-scratching. You have your so-called franchise quarterback. Why in the hell wouldn't you do more to protect the guy? And knowing year in and year out that this continues to be an issue, and year in and year out, you choose to criminally neglect that position. It has to be frustrating for Seahawks and Giants fans, knowing that you have a championship level defense, but you have a bush league ass offensive line that is ultimately going to keep you from getting to where your team could possibly go, which is the promised land. Week one is great. Week one is exciting. We wait for months for the season to begin. But I wonder why. As this slate of games, week one was boo-boo. You had only two games decided by 3 points or less. That was Pittsburgh and Cleveland and the Monday night nightcap between the Chargers and the Broncos. You had 10 games that were decided by 10 or more points. For all the things the NFL needs to figure out, for all the things the NFL focuses on, the single biggest thing they need to focus on is improving the quality of play, because this was a major issue last year. And it continues to be, at least through 1 week, a major issue we're going to run up against this year. And finally, anthem protest. If it's okay for the NFL to take taxpayer money to pump out pro-military, pro-government propaganda, then to me it should be perfectly fine, even though not looking good for the NFL from a business standpoint. So I understand why their panties are in a bunch. If players want to protest the national anthem, I'm all for it, especially with some of the things this country and this flag does ultimately represent. With that said, To me, it is one of those things where you either go all the way or you don't do it at all. To the players that sit there and stand around the guy that's courageous enough and ballsy enough to take a knee, when you sit there and put your hand on your shoulder, you're not showing any support. You're showing how big of a pussy you are. If you believe that strongly in a cause and you think the guy is right and you think the cause is just, then put up or shut up. Don't half-ass it and let your boy blow in the breeze. Step up to the plate, man up, and do something about it, and get on a knee or take a seat your damn self. So that was week one of the 2017 NFL season as me, the Schleg Daddy, saw it. Feel free to chime in the comment section what you thought about some of my hot takes from 4th and 10. Let me know what you thought about this week of football and what, if anything, the NFL can do to improve the clearly lacking quality of play. And make sure, most importantly of all, if you haven't done so already, subscribe to this channel and go to social media and spread the word that this channel right here is where it's at for NFL talk, commentary, and analysis. And let them know that I am the Schleg Daddy, the most underrated NFL and sports guy here on YouTube. Do it. Do it now. Spread it like a plague, baby.